in my bones. So good, I never felt this strong. And I can't hold it in no more. The truth will set me free, I'm sure. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I.
Not thicker.
Jimmy, what the hell did you do?
Then betrayal.
How in the hell could anyone do that to their own twin brother?
And this Friday, the hits.
Roman Reigns continues to rule.
Keep coming.
Escobar, Theory battle for the United States Championship.
Friday Night SmackDown, live this Friday, 8, 7 Central, only on Fox.
The city of brotherly love. It's got its own beat. The birthplace of America, where you're always reminded there's tough, and then there's Philly tough. Next April, the knockout punch is coming.
This is the greatest live event in entertainment.
And that's a Philly day. WrestleMania, live from Philadelphia, April 2024. Tickets available 1 week from Friday.
Into this post-SummerSlam edition of WWE's The Bump. We are still coming down from the event that was the biggest party of the summer in Detroit, Michigan. Matt, and then a lot happened on Raw. We were fortunate enough to be together to watch much of SummerSlam on Sunday when we did our post show that we filmed it Saturday night pretty late. But have you had time to kind of simmer down and digest everything that we witnessed at SummerSlam and on Raw?
No, do we ever, because it never stops. It goes that much quicker. 2 days after SummerSlam, where a lot of major events went down. Some things may have come to a close. A lot of new stories began. Maybe some new contenders emerged out of Monday Night Raw.
I'm still unwinding for everything we saw with Shinsuke Nakamura on Raw. But before we dive into all of that, we got to send it out to our social corner where Ryan Popola is monitoring everything that's going on in the WWE universe. Ryan, what's going on?
Yeah, absolutely, Megan. I would say not only are things not simmering, they're still sizzling, and that's going throughout all of social media. And if you want to be a part of talking about all things SummerSlam, Raw, NXT, and what's ahead, you know the deal. Hashtag WWE The Bump on all the platforms, Facebook, X, Instagram. If you're in the YouTube chat, I am talking to you right now in real time throughout the hour. If you have comments, questions, anything across the board, for our guests or recapping the week that was, and as we begin to look ahead, hashtag WWE The Bump for the next hour. Megan.
Ryan, thanks so much. Well, let's talk about our guests that are coming on The Bump today. We have some star-studded guests. First up, ahead of his massive opportunity for a United States Championship, he will face Austin Theory this Friday on Friday Night SmackDown. It is Santos Escobar. We also have someone who made their return to WWE and surprised us all on Monday Night Raw. It's the New Day, and Kofi Kingston is joining us. And then, of course, we have the one and only, the last professional broadcaster, Sam Roberts, will be in studio with us to break down SummerSlam, only in the way that Sam Roberts can do so. But Matt, we have a lot to get to before we get to all of our guests, especially after what we saw happen on Monday Night Raw.
Monday Night Raw, as we take you back here, the night started with, surprisingly, Seth freaking Rollins, Cody Rhodes, and Sami Zayn finding themselves on the same page to fight off Judgment Day to set up a six-man tag main event. However, during the night, we would see Shinsuke Nakamura defeat Big Bronson Reed. After he was going to be interviewed, there was a commotion, and JD McDonagh, who has apparently found his friendship with Finn Balor once again, was beating the hell out of Sami Zayn, had about a golf ball-sized ball on the end of his elbow. He's out of the match. Shinsuke steps up. So Shinsuke and Seth goes, I got plenty of respect for you. You're in. That takes us to right here. It's our six-man main event. Didn't think we'd be talking about Cody Rhodes and Seth freaking Rollins on the same side. And throughout the night, we wondered, would they be on the same page? They came to an agreement. Okay, Shinsuke's with us. Let's see what happens. As I said, this was Shinsuke's second match of the night, had already defeated Big Bronson Reed in Judgment Day. I think they're still having some of their issues. Whether it be what happened at, of course, SummerSlam with the cash-in or not cash-in, Finn Balor kind of going on his own to attack Cody and Seth and Sami at the beginning of the show, but Judgment Day would be up to their old antics. You see Rhea Ripley getting involved after she had been attacked by Raquel Rodriguez, and there's the Money in the Bank briefcase, but there's Sami Zayn, and you could see his elbow far from 100%, but not happy at what happened at the hands of JD McDonagh, which is going to ruin the briefcase usage by Judgment Day. Seth will take advantage, super kick to the briefcase to Finn, a crossroads right there. And Cody Rhodes, Seth freaking Rollins, and Shinsuke Nakamura are victorious. And Sammy, trying to mend all the fences. Hold on here. We know the history. A handshake. Everything those men have been through, a handshake from the World Heavyweight Champion, Seth freaking Rollins, to the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes. But then this happens. A Kinshasa to Seth freaking Rollins. Not what we expected at all. Cody at a loss. Sammy trying to figure out what's going on. We all thought it would be a problem between Cody and Seth, and instead, it is Shinsuke Nakamura taking advantage of the main event spotlight, Megan, and I don't think it's hard to connect the dots. Shin is tired of people getting his business,
yes,
trying
he
to
is.
Carve his own path. He went after the World Heavyweight Champion.
Yeah, this is, we've seen this brewing within Shinsuke for quite a while. We saw him hold the pants last week on Monday Night Raw to pick up his victory. And then, you know, poor Sammy. He's been trying so hard to be the peacemaker. He got Cody and Rollins right on the same page. But then Shinsuke comes out of here. And this is not the only thing that we have to keep our eye on, because tension is brewing backstage on Monday Night Raw. And it starts with The Miz, who he might be getting just a little bit jealous of LA Knight, and I'm sure a lot of people are getting jealous of LA Knight, especially what we saw on Saturday at SummerSlam.
Yeah, well, of course, LA Knight did win the SummerSlam Battle Royal, and LA Knight was getting some pictures taken, and, well, Miz didn't like the fact that he had to wait, and one of our wonderful photographers, G, was like, hey, Miz, you got to wait about 3 minutes or more because LA Knight is getting his pictures taken. He was a victor at SummerSlam. Miz didn't like that, and, well, Miz and LA Knight had quite the memorable war of words.
You became every single champion you could here, and you did it many times over, and good on you. I haven't been there yet, but here I am on the climb, and your career's in the damn toilet. I tell you what, if you want to make this personal now that you have, I don't mind making you a stepping stone.
Stepping stone? Stepping stone?
Don't get hot. I ain't talking about your little stepping stones down there. I'm talking about me walking over you to the main event where I belong.
I am the main event! I am the main event, and you are not on my level!
That's a really interesting theory that I'm not on your level, because strangely enough, I'm looking you dead in your eyes right now. So if you think I'm not on your level, why don't you prove me wrong? I ain't going anywhere.
Cheap shot. Of course he did.
And now Miz, he's gone.
Miz hammering away on LA Knight. The jealousy and rage.
Skull crushing finale.
And LA Knight, though, able to turn it around into a BFT. Blunt force trauma.
Miz. Listen, you're right now in the way of a man who is skyrocketing to the top of WWE, wins the SummerSlam Battle Royal presented by Slim Jim, got a Slim Jim commercial out of it, shows up in Minneapolis on Monday night to do that to The Miz. He was at Citi Field last night. We'll talk more about that, but I thought it was interesting that Miz was like, oh, you're an Attitude Era, a fanboy knockoff. Mm-hmm. Apparently, Miz been listening to Kevin Nash. And then I was like, remember when The Miz was on Real World and yeah. called himself The Miz, pretended to be The Rock? LA Knight is his own man. So is The Miz. I feel Miz might be feeling a little bit jealousy of what's going on
yeah,
with LA Knight right now.
Pot calling the kettle black a little bit there as it relates to LA Knight and The Miz. I see confidence out of LA Knight. And obviously, he deserves that confidence because he has the crowd behind him. And he's coming off a massive victory, as you mentioned, the SummerSlam Battle Royal.
And a signature victory. And that's what Dragon Lee was looking for last night on NXT, a signature victory. He had his opportunity, and what an opportunity it was for the North American Championship against Dirty Dom. Rhea obviously out there at Dirty Dom, but Dragon Lee having the Hall of Famer Rey Mysterio in his corner, and Rey is not going to let his son, his scumbag son, as Michael Cole would say, use the North American Championship, but behind the referee's back, the Women's World Champion Rhea Ripley would use her title, and Dom would get the victory as he continues to rack up these wins, and Rhea would stick it in Rey's face, but Lyra Valkyria, who has actually gotten a lot of love, a lot of respect from Rhea as of late, she's not having it. She takes out the Women's World Champ, Dragon Lee, Lyra Valkyria, standing tall to end NXT, and not typical that we see Rhea and Dom kind of backing off, but another victory for Dominic Mysterio to keep the North American
He's on a roll these days. Dirty Dom getting things done, defending his title. I was shocked to see Lyra out there, especially, Matt, after you mentioned everything that she's been through. But she's been telling us for a while now. She's grown these wings, and she is a new Lyra. So we'll have to wait and see what is next for Lyra Valkyria and Rhea Ripley. But let's send it out to Ryan. Ryan, what is the WWE Universe saying?
Well, Megan, Matt mentioned that people were looking for signature wins last night on NXT. A signature win did happen on Monday this past week. We're going to talk about Chad Gable here. As Crispy points out, Chad wins an incredible Fatal 4-Way and is now the number one contender for a future title opportunity at Gunther. An incredibly emotional win, and it got even more emotional for all the best reasons, as Sal points here. This was a touching moment of Chad Gable celebrating with his son. Chad would talk about that himself after the fact on Monday night, saying, Minnesota, you are all rock stars. Thank you for tonight. I won't ever forget it, and neither will he. An incredibly special moment, which is a bummer we have to contrast that with what Shinsuke Nakamura did to Seth freaking Rollins on Monday, because John says here, Shinsuke took out Seth Rollins, and then that look is what really is bad news for all parties involved, because when Shinsuke has that look, it is never, ever good positive news for the people that he is looking at. Shaq here says, Shinsuke's gone rogue. What he did, he went rogue on Seth freaking Rollins. We didn't get any comments from Shinsuke, though. Obviously, a lot of mystery around this right now. He took to X, not with comments, though, just with this very, very symbolic image. We will have to see what unfolds between Shinsuke, Seth, as we continue forward here on Monday nights. Let's go back to SummerSlam, though, because it was the biggest ever party of the summer. A lot of records broken across the board. The most watched SummerSlam of all time. Highest grossing SummerSlam of all time. Largest great gate for any non-WrestleMania ever. Most sponsorship revenue. Highest merchandise sales. Most social views for SummerSlam ever. History was made at SummerSlam, which prompts us to say, thank you, WWE Universe, a SummerSlam for the ages as we now look ahead. Can't talk about SummerSlam, though, without talking about the SummerSlam Battle Royal, which means we're going to talk about LA Knight, who had an incredible moment at Citi Field with the Mets last night. Let's take a look at that right now. Megan, even though I know you're a White Sox fan, if you had been there at Citi, you would have been saying, yeah, proudly with all the other Metropolitans, and what a moment it was.
Ryan, you are right. I absolutely would have. I haven't stopped saying yeah, despite Matt trying to get me to stop. But you're a Mets fan. All the LGMers are right behind LA Knight. They are a part of this yeah movement.
Could have used a little positivity as a Mets fan, but I was happy to see LA Knight there. He was shooting out T-shirts, throwing out the first pitch, hanging out with Seaver the dog. LA Knight taking over the world from Detroit to Minneapolis to Queens and beyond, of course.
And Ryan, I'm a little surprised when you thank the WWE Universe, you didn't throw in a thank you Trish there. So I'm just calling you out on that one.
Thank you, Trish.
Thank you, Trish. There you go. Thank you, Shayna, also. Thank you, Shayna. Thank you, everybody. All right, well, we need to turn our attention to our very first guest who is coming on The Bump. Just moments away, it is a WWE superstar who is about to have the biggest match of his career. He is the number one contender for the United States Championship. A win over Austin Theory would give him his first singles title on the main roster and solidify not only his position as one of the best on SmackDown, but LWO as one of the most fierce groups in WWE. Everybody, please join me in welcoming Santos Escobar to The Bump. Santos!
Yeah!
Welcome back to The Bump. How are you doing today?
Familia, this is my house. This is mi casa. Thank you so much for having me. I'm very happy, motivated, strong, ready.
You're ready, and you need to be ready because you're ahead of one of the biggest matches in your career. What's going through your mind? How are you feeling this week?
Honestly, Meg, I feel really unbeatable. I feel ready, confident. Our business is a business of confidence. And if we measure confidence, I'm at 100 right now. 1,000, I might say.
I love it. Confidence is something you will need to take down Austin Theory, the United States champion. And we haven't seen you have a singles title here on SmackDown since you've been on the main roster. So what has your preparation been like ahead of this match and taking on someone like Austin Theory?
Well, with all due respect to Austin, I was born a champion. So this is no, I'm no stranger to titles or accolades or tournaments. I was this close at the finals of the World Cup with Ricochet, and now I find myself in the same position as I was before, which is at the gates of heaven, ready to collect a title.
And you have every reason to believe in yourself, not only for everything you just mentioned, but because of the multiple interactions you've had with Austin Theory over the last couple weeks. You have a victory over him. We know it went down in the SummerSlam Battle Royal. Do you feel like, Santos, you have shaken the usually uber-confident United States champion heading into your match on Friday?
That's exactly what happened. Like I said before, this is a business of confidence. And you will measure your victories and your defeats with the level of confidence that you came out that night. And this Friday night, I'm going to come out super confident because I've got Austin Theory's number. And like I said last Friday, what happened to him at the end of the night, that was not revenge. That's karma. And this guy has got it coming.
Might be a prediction of the future. We lost Santos there. I'm sure we'll get him back here for a second. But, Megan, I am not surprised to hear that level of confidence come out of Santos Escobar, whether it's been in this studio. Anytime I've talked to him, anytime we've seen him, that is what comes out of that man. And that is why I believe he could be on his way to the United States Championship this Friday. And we're going to get him back here in a second. So, Santos, I want to follow up here. You had to win two matches in United States Championship Invitational to get to this point. I think we all know it did not come the way you wanted with how you were able to ended up getting the victory over Rey Mysterio. How have you been able to focus back up after such a wide range of emotions on that night?
Well, you just mentioned it, and you said it beautifully. It's a wide range of emotions. This was not an easy task. This was not an easy endeavor. First, going over the phenomenal AJ Styles, Butch, Grayson Waller, and then going over Rey Mysterio. And the way the match went down, I'm not really happy with it. That was the biggest match of my career, the biggest match of my life, I might say, just because of all the emotions and because of who I was in front of. I gave my everything. We went hard at it, and the result was pretty obvious. I mean, it was either him or me, and I'm happy that we're both okay with the result.
And Santos, we had Rey Mysterio on the bump just a couple weeks ago. It's been so fun to watch you two work together. I've seen you two backstage before on SmackDown, and really just to watch you live out this dream. You looked up to Rey Mysterio, and when we had him on our show, he had some really nice things to say about you. So let's watch this.
Santos has an incredible heart. He has a desire and a passion to succeed. And like I said, Santos is the guy, definitely.
So what is it like for you? Not only do you get to spend so much time with Rey and what you're doing with LWO together, but to sit here in this chair right now ahead of one of the biggest matches of your career and hear a legend say those things about you. Well, we're going to hear from Santos in just a minute. Having a couple technical difficulties with Santos Escobar, but I can't wait to hear what he says about Rey Mysterio.
There he is.
And here he is, Santos.
I'm sorry, guys. It's just my emotions took over. No. But in all seriousness, he said.
All right.
Well, we will hear from Santos shortly, but I'm excited for him to have this opportunity, and I know Rey Mysterio is as well.
Yeah, and I think that's when we talked to Rey about that. It was just about, you know, how do we end up with the championship? And it wasn't about a rivalry. It was about respect, and Santos talked about how big that match was. But then on top of all that, knowing it would get you an opportunity at the United States Championship, Rey's been there before. Santos had not yet, and now he'll have that chance on Friday.
Of course. I think we do have Santos back with us now. So, Santos, I'm so sorry. I know this has been emotional for you, but we heard what Rey had to say. You're preparing for this massive opportunity. What does it feel like to hear those words from Rey?
Well, just piggybacking on what he said, he just mentioned heart, passion, and that I'm the guy. Now, the first two I've always had, and being the guy is something that I'm just realizing as of lately. That's what is boosting my confidence. That's what's getting me ready for this Friday night. And just Rey, I want you to know that I will fight this one for you, for me, and also por la raza, That's for all of us. I'm representing not just Santos Escobar, not just El Fantasma, not just my Latinos in the U.S., Latinos in Mexico or Latin America, but Latinos around the world. Friday night is the night for us to grab what's ours. And that is just the beginning. Trust me.
Absolutely, Santos. What's cool is when, Ray, that clip that we showed, it was a question about an incredibly special moment you had with a fan at a meet and greet during the Mexico tour. You brought the fan to ringside, spoke with them a little bit, and then ultimately you said this after the fact. I later apologized to him for coming out on top of the U.S. title and promised him I would get it for him always. Santos, this clip went like wildfire across social media in the best way possible. People love seeing you interact with the fan and then caring so much about the fan after the fact. For you, how meaningful is it to be able to have such an impact on a young person's life like that in those moments?
I always say what we do is put smiles on people's faces. That's the textbook definition of what we do. But I always take it one step further. And I say, if I can inspire people the way I was inspired by Triple H, Shawn Michaels, Rey Mysterio, Eddie Guerrero, you name it, then I've won. Then my life, my work, what I do has a purpose. That kid is me. 25 years ago, 30 years ago, I'm just trying to pass it on and I'm trying to inspire him. And I did apologize to him because I wanted to come through for my people in Mexico. But trust me, the job's done. And I'm sure we're going to come back with a premium live event, maybe WrestleMania. And I promise you, when that happens, Santos Escobar and La Raza are coming out on top.
Santos, I love that. And when talking about inspiration, it leads perfectly into this. You posted this over the weekend on SummerSlam Saturday. I'll read it. I migrated to America August 5th, 2019, full of goals and dreams. August 5th, 2023, now you're at Ford Field. Santos, I imagine looking around Ford Field on Saturday had to be a huge full circle moment, not just for your career, but probably for your life, yeah?
It was. And I apologize to some of the WWE members there because they were asking me, are you happy to be here? And on more than one occasion, I replied, I'm not. I want to be featured in a match. I want to have a match. I want to main event the whole thing. But then I understood what they were asking, and that's where this thought came from. I just migrated to this country and left everything behind. Dreams, aspirations, goals, full of them. But in reality, what was going to happen? No one knows. No one knows the future. Only hard work, dedication, sacrifice, and showing up every day is what gets you there. And that's where this stuff came from. I hadn't made that balance, and I'm really happy of where I am, but more importantly, where I'm going.
Santos, you're clearly so driven, and it's never enough for you. You're always looking at what you can do better. But this has been a massive year for you. You were a part of your first WrestleMania, and then you made your SummerSlam debut in a massive stadium at Ford Field, and you wore this Detroit World Order shirt. Have you had time to just focus on all that you have accomplished and how far you've come and really just take in that moment?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, shout out to Nick Khan and everything he's doing. This is a result of the company understanding the phenomenon behind their athletes, you know, behind the LA Knight movement, behind the Chad Gable movement, behind the LWO and Santos Escobar movement. I'm really happy, glad, satisfied, and also challenged because this means the company is seeing what I'm doing. They're observing, and now it's the ball is on my court. So you guys give me all of that. I'll give you my performance and then some.
Someone else I think that's been affected by that, you go back to, of course, Backlash in Puerto Rico, is part of the LWO, and Zelina Vega. And Santos, you know this, for the second time in a month, Zelina Vega defeated Io Sky just the day before Io would successfully cash in her Money in the Bank contract to become the WWE Women's Champion. I would have to think, Santos, there's got to be a lot of discussions within the LWO about how quickly Zelina can get her opportunity at EO and the WWE Women's Championship.
I think those two victories automatically turn Zelina into the number one contender. I have nothing but love, respect, and admiration for Zelina Vega. I love her, and I would love nothing more than to
All right, so...
See, Kayla's not here, so we can say nice things about Zelina Vega. I think that might be the first time in bump history that we've really, you know...
Well, it's a Kayla-Zelina thing, but I will say this. I think there is every reason to believe that Zelina can defeat Io for a third time. And she, look, I'm not Adam Pearce. I'm sure he's watching right now. I think we can think that way based on those two victories. But as we bring Santos back in, Santos talked about Zelina, but let's get it back to you here because we've talked to Ray about this, as Megan mentioned a couple weeks ago. I think you already feel this way. Heading into that United States Champion Invitational, it started with eight men. It came down to you and Ray, and now it is your opportunity this Friday. Considering everything that's happened since this all began, especially with Theory getting so involved in your business, what kind of pressure are you feeling to finish the job and bring the United States Championship to the LWO?
There is pressure for sure, Matt, but I have momentum. I have the confidence, and no one, especially Austin Theory, better mess with my momentum. This is my time. I've waited all my life for this moment, all of my life, my career, my dreams. This Friday, everything comes to fruition. So no one, especially Austin Theory, had better interject that trajectory. I'm going all the way to the top. The only thing I have to go through is this Friday night. And this specific match, which I know in my heart, in my mind, that I'm going to win.
All right, Santos, before we let you go, we know that you're ready for Austin Theory. We know that you're ready to hold up that United States Championship. But something that you've been working on a lot outside of the ring is your acting career. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Absolutely, Megan. I've been studying in L.A. at the Lee Strasberg Theater and Film Institute. I have so much admiration for Dwayne Johnson, John Cena, and all of the people that has transcended from what we do into the big screen. I also believe that it's always in my best interest to get better, to grow, to learn more. And this is my effort of doing exactly that, becoming the biggest superstar in your screen every Friday.
Santos, the sky is the limit for you. Best of luck to you against Austin Theory on Friday. And I can't wait to see what you accomplish next.
May I say something? I want to say something. Megan, you are a beautiful, wonderful human being. I said before, we put smiles on people's faces, and that's all of us. We're all in this together. But you inspire people. You inspired me. You're a beautiful, wonderful person, and I just want to hug you, and I hope I can see you soon so I can hug you in person.
Santos, we're going to make that happen.
Just what I wanted
Thank
to
you
say.
So much. I miss seeing you backstage on SmackDown, but I'm very excited for you on Friday, and best of luck against Austin Theory. Thank you so much for coming on The Bump.
It's got nothing to do with luck. It's all heart.
He's got it. He's ready.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Santos Escobar, for coming out. I think he's going to walk away as champ. That was fantastic.
I expect it. No one would be mad if Austin Theory was sad at the end of Friday night.
Well, before we get to our next guest, we have to talk about what's going on ahead of WrestleMania 40. Tickets are available starting next week. And, of course, WWE Shop has tons of new merchandise brought to you by Fanatics. Let's take a look at what they have going on ahead of WrestleMania.
The city of brotherly love. It's got its own beat. The birthplace of America, where you're always reminded there's tough, and then there's Philly tough. Next April, the knockout punch is coming.
This is the greatest live event in entertainment.
And that's a Philly day. WrestleMania, live from Philadelphia, April 2024. Tickets available 1 week from Friday.
Welcome back, everyone. everybody to The Bump. As you can see, we have our very own Sam Roberts here live and in studio with us. Sam, while you're here, welcome, first of all. Thank you so much for coming.
Come on, thank you for having me.
Oh, it's our honor to have you here. There's no one who can talk SummerSlam like you, and we figured since you're here, let's have you on for the Kofi Kingston interview, too.
I would love to talk to Kofi Kingston.
Yeah, but before we get to Kofi Kingston and all of those things, I don't know if you guys have noticed. I'm sure you have. There are some brand new titles in WWE. Yes, they are absolutely beautiful, and they are available on WWE Shop. We actually have the titles here in studio. Matt Camp's going to talk about them, and Sam and I are going to be Vanna White. We're going to...
Yeah, let's show them off. And by the way, as you can see, we have a QR code here. It's right below me. There it is. And that will direct you to ordering these two new beautiful titles. Sam, we're going to start with you. You have the undisputed WWE Universal Championship replica title right there as you're taking it out of the bag. And yes, it does indeed come with that carrying cloth case. But when you take it out, you're probably going to leave it out forever because the undisputed WWE Universal Championship represents the champion of all champions and the ultimate prize in sports entertainment. Now you could go for gold by adding this prestigious undisputed WWE Universal Championship replica title to your collection. Revealed to the world on June 2nd, 2023 during SmackDown, to, of course, the head of the table, Roman Reigns, this championship is a must-have for any WWE fan and title collector. You got acrylic stones on there. They're clear and they're red and they're black. This thing weighs about 8 pounds, a little bigger than a brand new baby, and you want to treat this baby well, believe me. Snap fasteners, the carrying case. It is fantastic. Now, that's just one of the two championships we're going to show
over. It brings out your eyes a little.
Let's go over to Monday Night Raw because that is Megan freaking Moran, and she has the world heavyweight championship. The newly unveiled WWE World Heavyweight Championship is the pinnacle of sports entertainment. Now you can own this replica, official replica title, modeled after the championship, which debuted to the WWE Universe on April 24th, 2023. This championship title is a must-have for any WWE title collector. Make your collection gold with the richest prize in all of WWE. That one's about 9 pounds. It's got the side plates there. Also a carrying case for you, the interchangeable side plates. If you're not Seth freaking Rollins, you can get your own, and there you go. Two new championships, I'm sure plenty more to come, and make sure you hit up that QR code so you can get yours right now, the undisputed WWE Championship and the World Heavyweight Championship.
Can I keep this here for the rest of the show?
It's gonna go behind, well, you can keep it there,
right here.
Sure.
I think I need my own side plates here.
The Megan side plates.
Well, speaking of champions, one of the most decorated WWE superstars in history, one of my personal favorites, and yours, please welcome on to The Bump, Kofi Kingston.
Yeah!
Oh, there he is.
There he is.
Kofi, yes. Welcome back to The Bump, and welcome back to WWE. How you feeling?
I feel fantastic. First and foremost, Meg, look, you deserve to have a championship title. You are a champion,
Meg.
Oh,
thank you,
you know
so
what I mean?
Much. Thank
Nobody
you.
Nobody is more of a champion than you. I know I told you on social media, but I admire you so much and your sacrifices and everything that you have done. You are an incredible human being. So you should, Matt, don't try to tell her to put the title in the background. She deserves to have a title.
Just hold it up, the whole show. Let's go. I mean, this thing is a little bit heavy here. But Kofi, Monday night was a total surprise to all of us. But I'm sure it wasn't a surprise to you. What did it feel like to get back out there in front of the WWE Universe in Minneapolis?
It felt incredible. It felt amazing. It was weird because so when me and Woods walked into the building, we both got like this, like almost like anxiety. You know what I'm saying? Just like walking in and being back into the fold. I have never been out of action for as long as I was. I think it was almost like 5 months to the day. I think I got hurt on March 3rd. Then I had my surgery on 3/16. I can remember that.
Nice.
And I've just not been out for that long. So it was a little bit strange, you know, to be back in the fold and in the locker room. Of course, everything is, it's always business as usual. The world always goes on when you're not there, you know what I mean, in terms of WWE. But it felt good. It felt like, you know, it felt good to be just back home, you know. So, yeah, definitely excited to be back. Myself and Woods, we are looking forward to just reinfecting the WWE Universe with the power of positivity. As we all know, there have been some a lot of there's a lot of hate going on, man. But I don't know what the Usos, you know, you got the I don't even know whether they're calling the Hurt Business or not, you know, Dawkins and Tez. I mean, what is going on? We leave for 5 months and all of a sudden everybody, all this anger is going on, man. So we just got to reinfect the WWE universe with that power of positivity once again.
Kofi, you did that on multiple occasions with Jackie Redmond. Thank you for that. That is her rite of passage, both between Raw and about 5 minutes on Raw Talk, which I certainly appreciate, as did Megan, as we did the show. But you also got back in the ring. You look clean as hell with that new gear, by the way. 10 on the clean scale with those J1s. I know that. But you got back in there with the Viking Raiders, and I know you've had your issues with them in the past. What was it like getting back in there and being victorious after, like you said, 5 months out of the ring?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it was like riding a bike, to be honest. I was like, just having been away from the ring for that long, you always have these just questions in the back of your mind, like, oh, am I going to forget how to do this? You know, are the people going to forget who I am? You know what I mean? And then especially with my ankle injury, you know, I'm like, am I still going to be able to, like, do what I do? Am I still going to be able to move around well out there? But fortunately, the WWE Universe has a way of just making all the pain and everything go away. As soon as you walk through those curtains, you just don't feel anything, like, pain-wise. There's just such a rush of adrenaline, and you go out there and you do what you do. So that's what we did. It was fantastic. It was incredible.
The hops are still there in a very big way, as we saw right there. So no worry about that. Now, the Viking Raiders had their second Viking Rules match a couple of weeks ago against Alpha Academy. Kofi, you are a veteran of that match, of course, going back to SmackDown and Raw. But how much did you enjoy the display of brutality between the Viking Raiders and Alpha Academy a couple weeks ago?
Man, what a match. I mean, I think that we in the locker room have all known how incredible Gable is. And Otis too. You know, I think in the past like 2 years, 3 years or so, Otis has really shown a lot of range, character-wise, personality-wise. He's the kind of guy who can make you, like, you know, he kind of reminds me of Big E a little bit, you know, in the sense that he can make you, like, be very afraid of him. He can show off his grueling strength, but he can also make you laugh. He really has a lot of range, and Gable is just incredible on so many levels, as you would expect an Olympic gold medalist would be, you know? But I'm so glad that they're getting the chance to really display what they can do, because there's a lot of people on the roster who have so much talent, and oftentimes we don't get the chance to display it, and a lot of people don't know. So I hope that the people realize, like, how incredible Otis and Gable are. And even, like, Maxine, too, right?
Oh,
like, her coming along, I think, like, their dynamic is amazing. She's really embraced what's been happening here. I mean, you know, her career, even thus far, like, it's kind of been, like, all over the place. But she's always able to kind of roll with the punches and make the best out of whatever she's given. And that's really the key to being able to survive and thrive as a WWE superstar. So I think that they really have a good thing going with the Alpha Academy, a great dynamic and great chemistry. So I'm excited to seeing what they can do. I'm excited to be able to hopefully mix it up with them down the line. We'll see what happens, but I'm really happy for them for sure.
Kofi, the tag division is stacked right now, and they all deserve as much credit as you're giving them, but you called yourselves gods of the tag team division. You're at this point, it's in double digits, the amount of times that you've held the tag team champion. So those that pray to the altar of the gods of the tag team division, how should they worship?
Look, as long as you go out there and you do as good as you can, you do the best that you can, you bring your full self to the tag team division, that is how you pay tribute. And it's not just to us, it's to all the tag teams that really came before us, man. Like, tag team wrestling is special. You show your link with your partner, and to be on the same page and to do it as a team is completely, totally different than being able to do it on your own. So, you know, all jokes aside, I think that when people talk about the tag team division, we just have to do our part to make it special. And like you said, like, right now, the tag team division is stacked. There's so much variety out there with the characters and just the chemistry and all that. So, yeah, man. Yeah, we meant what we said. You know, we stepped away for a little while, let everybody get their little comeuppance, you know what I'm saying? Build yourselves up. But then it was the Viking Raiders who said they were going to make a sacrifice to the gods. I said this earlier on Monday. you said you're going to make a sacrifice to the gods. I said, we didn't ask for a sacrifice. We didn't ask for that. You know what I'm saying? So we had to come down and address. When you use the God's name in vain, they come down and they make you pay. You know how it is in the scriptures. We're just doing what we said we were going to do.
Kofi, a lot to be excited about, as you just said. Right now in the YouTube chat, Andrea Price and others, I'm sure you know this, are so excited to see you back. But Kofi, in some ways, you never really left because you were on WWE Celebrity Family Feud. We talked to Bayley and Woods about this last week. Bayley is desperate for a rematch, Kofi. I don't know how you feel about that. But the experience overall, Kofi, what was it like to be a part of this? What were your big takeaways from it?
It was amazing. As much as intense as it came off on television, I don't even think that it really accurately reflected the amount of stress, the amount of just like excitement. Everybody, you know, the men and the women were also competitive, right? Like, we're all super competitive and we really, really wanted to win. So for a while, it looked like we were gonna get blanked. It looked like we weren't even gonna put a point on the board. The women were just like, they were owning the entire game to the point where, like, the producer came out in between takes and she was like, well, hey, you guys really got to step your game up, man. Like, let's go. I know you guys can do this. And she's like trying to motivate us. But from her perspective, it wasn't good television because they were like just dominating the whole time. So then we stepped it up, man. And we came through one at the last second with the buzzer beater, if you will. I feel like it couldn't have gone any better than it did. And Steve Harvey is an incredible, incredible talent, man. Like, he's in between, like, you know, the takes and everything and the commercials, he's giving like a sermon to the crowd. He's giving a stand-up comedy show to them, you know, talking with us. And he's just like as incredibly talented as you thought he would be, and a stellar human being too. So, yeah, the whole experience was fantastic. I'm so glad that we won, you know, but as far as that rematch is concerned, I don't know. I don't know if I'm in the position to grant it, I'll probably say no. You know what I'm saying? You get one shot. What did Eminem say in that song? You only get one shot. Do not blow your chance. You know the lyric, you know? And that's it. I don't know if I want to go back and go through all that stress again. I got one gray hair over this
Kofi, it's fair.
I got one gray hair. I don't need more.
Fair enough. A great comeback on Celebrity Family Feud. A great comeback on Monday. Kofi, let's bring it full circle because you posted this recently. I mean, this connected with a lot of people. I worked at Staples headquarters from 2003 through 2006. During that time, we did a corporate photo shoot with some products to be posted in stores nationwide. 2023 and they're still up. A friendly reminder of life's chapters. A couple coworkers sent this pic to me yesterday. How did they recognize me without my dreads and facial hair? Kofi, just an incredible full circle moment. So as you begin this next chapter in WWE after a five-month to break away, what's it like to look back on those former chapters?
It's crazy. I really try not to look back so much because I'm still here, you know what I mean? I'm still in it. I try to really kind of like just stay present in the moment. Even with being away for so long, a lot of people ask like, oh, are you anxious to get back? And I'm like, like the I guess political and proper answer should be yes. But for me, it was just like focusing on the fact that I was home for 5 months. And if I'm looking so far ahead, I'm ignoring like what's in front of me, right? Like, so my family is here and I get to enjoy my family. So I'm enjoying them fully and being fully present and not looking too far in the future, not looking too far in the past and being mad about like what happened injury wise and wondering if I could have done anything different. I just try to stay present in the moment. So when I do get the chance to look back, I think that, you know, thus far I've been really fortunate to have had a great career and I'm fortunate for all of it, really. I mean, it's been over 15 years, which is like disgusting to say because there's been a lot of these, you know, young booties coming up to me. Like, hey, man, I used to watch you when I was a kid. Now they're like taller than me. They show me pictures when like they were shorter than me. You know, so I'm not, I don't know, like I got my hat on to the side, you know what I mean? Like, I'm still him. I'm not that old. Don't make me feel old. Come up to me and tell me that stuff. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, man, I try to stay present in the moment, but at the same time, I do have an appreciation for the journey in getting here. So, yeah, I'll never take that for granted. But, yeah, people, the WWE universe is crazy, man. Like, I just don't understand how you would recognize. I've never been on TV with short hair and no facial hair, you know? And when I've had no facial hair, it's been very short stints. But the fact that you can recognize me on a wall wearing like a pink magenta, like baseball three-quarter sleeve shirt, you know what I'm saying? And this like weird smile, like my face is weird. Like the last time I shaved my face, I had to grow my facial hair back out as soon as possible because I don't like my face anymore. I forgot what I look like. It's very awkward. It's very strange, you know? So the fact that they can recognize me on a wall in Staples is crazy. And the fact that that picture is even still up there, I should be charging some royalties.
Residuals.
Yes. Like, yeah.
The percentage of the sales. I mean, something's up. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Back to school with Kofi Kingston.
What do you guys think?
Back to school with Kofi Kingston. This is a busy time of year at Staples. And I mean, it looks like that you're the face of it. And Kofi, speaking of being the face of organizations, when before we got to talk to you last time, you've had a monumental recognition from Boys and Girls Club of America. They inducted you into their Alumni Hall of Fame. And obviously you've accomplished a lot in WWE, but to be recognized by an organization that had such a profound impact on your life, where does that rank in what you've accomplished?
It's pretty surreal. It's probably one of the more surreal moments because, you know, so there's a syndrome called imposter syndrome.
Yes.
Where you don't feel like you deserve what you're getting, right? So I kind of had to fight that with this whole Boys and Girls Club Hall of Fame scenario because I feel like they're the ones who provided me with a safe place to go. There's a lot of people who I grew up with that, you know, like didn't make it, you know, because they got involved in things that were, you know, dangerous lifestyles and things of that nature. And luckily I just had the place, you know, a place like the Boys and Girls Club to keep me out of all of that and keep me away from all of that. So I feel like I owe them. For them to be recognizing me is very bizarre. I really had to just like push through all of that and, you know what I mean? Like just accept the award. But it is really truly an honor because there's so many people there. And even like the stage that we share with all the other inductees and hearing all of their stories, like every single day, the Boys and Girls Club is helping people and saving lives, essentially, you know, providing a safe space for people to go while, you know, a parent might have to work a 60, 70 hour week. You know, like you need that. You need that. People need that. And it's amazing that they've been able to do it for so long. So to be a part of that system, to be a part of that foundation, it's just it's a real honor. You know, I'm still kind of I just kind of don't believe that it happened because it's not something you like set out to do. Right. Like if you're a WWE superstar, you say, OK, one day I'm going to be in the Hall of Fame. You know, you work on your career. But for someone to come out of the blue and say, hey, we want you to be in our Hall of Fame because of the impact that you're having with the Boys and Girls of America is it's very humbling, you know, so very appreciative of that for sure. And, you know, I've told them like anything that I can do to kind of help like lift them up or put them on a platform, I'll always do that because they just have such a profound impact on so many people that they touch.
Kofi, you've had that impact, whether you're in the ring or out of the ring, 5 months away, you're still a busy guy, Dream Convention, Boys and Girls Club Hall of Fame, Family Feud. And at the Family Feud, I got to say, I was happy to see you back alongside your captain, Seth freaking Rollins, but I would be an irresponsible journalist if I didn't ask you about potential aspirations for this right here, the World Heavyweight Championship. Something new since you've been away. Your feelings on this and the captain as the champion?
Yeah, I think it's amazing. I think the captain is doing a fantastic job as, number one, as a leader, as a locker room leader over the years. He's somebody that has always had amazing matches, but has always been kind of like a pioneer in this industry. And he's kind of risen up through the ranks against a lot of odds, and now he's at the top, you know? So a lot of respect for him in that sense. We call him the captain for a reason, you know what I'm saying? He's, you know, always willing to put the company on his back and put the industry on his back and represent to the highest capacity. So always a lot of respect there. But having said that, you know what I mean? Like everybody wants a taste of that gold. I think he understands that being at the top, you always have a target on your back. You know what I mean? So I think I don't think he would be mad or anything if myself or Woods decided to pursue that goal. You know, becoming the WWE World Heavyweight Champion is we're real greedy. I've said it on here a lot of times. when it comes to gold, we want to hold all the titles. I'm talking about, you know, WWE title, World Heavyweight title, the women's title, the women's tag title.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, all we want all the title, the 24/7 title. We want all of them. We want them all. We're really greedy when it comes to accolades and gold and things of that nature. So, I think Seth knows he's got the big target on his back. So it is what it is.
Well, on that note of greed and your motivations for being back after 5 months, right? You kind of touched on the fact that you're 15 years in, like you've accomplished a lot and you've seen a lot from singles titles to WrestleMania moments to tag team titles. However, at the same time, you are wearing a sideways hat and you're wrestling cool sneakers, so you're one of these kids too. What are the goals going forward? Are we entering in to this Raw locker room to give lessons and give wisdom to these kids, or are we going in to beat them down and take what they have?
Yeah, well, first and foremost, we're going in to play a lot of Tekken. We're bringing Tekken back into the locker room. Mm-hmm. Tekken 8's coming out, you know what I'm saying, next year. I came to the locker room in Minnesota this past Monday, and people were playing Mario Kart, which is fine. They're gaming, but we need to get the Tekken boat back on the river. You know what I'm saying? But I think that, I've obviously been around for a long time, so I have a lot of knowledge to give to people, and I've always been one to, like, allow people to, like, have their own journey, you know what I'm saying? Make their own mistakes and figure things out for themselves. And if they want my advice, I'll more than happily give the advice because so much great advice was given to me. And having said that as well, I mean, being on the WWE roster, if you're not trying to like level up, then you probably shouldn't be on the roster. You know what I mean? So I don't think that I'm quite at a stage where it's like, okay, well, I'm just coming in to just give of myself to everybody and not worry about myself, you know? So I think myself and Woods, like that's always the goal. We're always trying to, for as much success as we've had, for as many records as we've had, we're trying to have a lot more success, break a lot more records, you know, break more ceilings and keep on like doing what we can to leave a lasting memory and a lasting impression on this industry when it's all said and done. And by doing that for yourself, you're opening doors for other people and you're making the industry itself larger. So you're doing it for the business. So you have to be a little bit selfish in that sense. It's a long-winded answer. I don't even know if I answered your question. But that's the goal is always to be as successful as possible, to make as many memories for people as possible, you know, put as many smiles on faces as possible, but to also just have, have as much success for your own career as you can as well.
Well, Kofi, we are certainly looking forward to the next chapter. Keep that hat on sideways. Keep wearing the cool shoes. You are the cool kid. Don't let anybody tell you any different, all right?
You see it? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Kofi, looking great. We're so excited that you're back in WWE. And best of luck, because I know you're going to accomplish big things, and we all can't wait to see them.
Thanks, Kofi.
Thank you so much. Always a pleasure, you know what I mean? And thank you guys for having me on. It's great to just jump right back in the pool.
Yes.
You know, I can't swim. You know, I'll be in the shallow end, but I'm in there getting wet. I'm getting wet once again. It's all good. It feels great.
Awesome, Kofi. Thank you so much. Oh, he's just—he's absolutely the best.
That's like the same. Like he looks exactly like he did walking the beach in 2008 with the guy at the flip.
He hasn't aged.
The same person.
Not at all.
He has not aged at all. Okay, well, we got to get into everything that happened at SummerSlam, and what better people to break it down with than Sam Roberts and Matt Camp? These two know more about wrestling than anybody in the world. But Sam, you were there in person,
yes,
on the ground in Detroit, Michigan.
Feet on the ground.
What was your biggest takeaway?
I mean, the energy all weekend. It's so fun watching WWE come and take over a city. And I know you hear WWE people talk about this all the time, but it's so true, from going to the Superstore and seeing everybody walk around with WWE shirts on. I mean, I just love, like, everywhere that I went, there was someone going, "Hey, Sam, Jay or Roman. Hey, Sam, Cody or Brock." And it's like,
you're a celeb.
Why? Well, I'm more than a
professional broadcaster. People want to know what Sam Roberts thinks, which is why you're here on the bump.
You just made that answer come across as far more self-serving than I intended, but I will take it.
No, you are. Your opinion matters.
Thank
you. Let's get your opinion on this, because we know what happened with Jimmy and Jay.
Yeah.
Jimmy being the one to ultimately stop Jay from being the head of the table, the tribal chief, and the undisputed WWE Universal Champion. We will hear from Jimmy in 2 days on SmackDown. What did you make of his actions?
So we know what happened, but I don't think anybody quite knows why it happened. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's left people in such this state of confusion that they don't even know what to make of the bloodline anymore. And it's rare that you have a singular moment have that kind of impact on that many people. But it was also so cool, and you could hear it as you're watching on Peacock. A stadium full of people first have that collective gasp when the mask comes down, and then collectively voice their opinion to Jimmy Uso for turning on his brother.
Is it directed at Jay? Is it more, I think, is the question we're going to probably find out. But it feels like you look at the bloodline. And Roman is winning. But it's getting a little hairier time.
You know, and I heard you guys talking about this on the post show.
Am I wrong?
And I was insulted for them. I thought it was disrespectful. Wow. Like, I was watching you guys talk about it, and you're sitting there like, oh, Roman's not so good at winning anymore.
She said he's beatable.
Yeah, he didn't beatable. Get beat.
Won. Jay had him until Jimmy came out there.
He had him. Everybody has him.
Jay had him.
But then they don't walk out with the title. So many people, it's like, he had him. He didn't have him, because if he had him, he'd be the champion today.
Well, what if Jimmy wasn't there?
I don't know. Mm-hmm. What if anything? What if I had wings? I could fly right now. It'd be amazing. But it's not reality.
Jay had him.
If you were flying, you wouldn't be on the show.
Sam, let's switch gears to the beginning of SummerSlam. Let's talk about Logan Paul. Sam, I've talked to you after many of Premium Live events, and you're always looking ahead, the trajectory for what's next for any given superstar. This is what Logan Paul had to say after the fact, after SummerSlam, whatever it takes. Sam, for you, as Logan Paul now moves forward, what do you think you would do next if you were Logan Paul, or what do you think he will do next as he begins to continue here?
I think Logan Paul, as he continues, has to get bigger and bigger matches. I mean, the match with Ricochet was huge for Logan. And I think that Logan has to continue to prove himself as a WWE superstar. That's the move.
All right, Sam, I'm not going to lie. Heading into SummerSlam, I was really concerned about damage control. They were not on the same page whatsoever. It seemed that way. But then it all came together. At the biggest party of the summer, Io was able to cash in, and Bayley helping her do so, which we saw her hurt earlier on when Io may have thought about cashing in, but it doesn't matter. She got the job done. She is the champ. What does this say about where Damage Control is headed into their second year? Because this is the 1 year anniversary. It's a big deal for these ladies.
Damage Control are becoming the queens of SummerSlam. They show up on the scene, and a year later, they're now representing the WWE Women's Division at the highest possible level. And Io beats Bianca Belair to get that championship. That is an incredible moment. And this right here, this is why it's so dangerous, Megan, to say things like, oh, the Damage Control, I don't think they're on the same page. Oh, Roman, I think he's beatable. Because look what's happening right in front
of us. They proved me wrong. I had questions about Bayley. I had questions about Damage Control as a unit. And I don't think I'm wrong to question that.
They got it back together, Sam. Did. You can they at did. Least admit that at the right time.
I don't know if they were ever on separate pages.
Okay.
I don't know.
What I do want to ask you about, though, is what happened on Monday Night Raw, because we were worried about, I think, Cody and Seth being on the same page. They shake hands, and Shinsuke Nakamura is going to take the perfect opportunity to make a case for that man right there, because they're all celebrating, and then we get a Kinshasa.
Boom.
Your thoughts on Shinsuke Nakamura's statement to the World Heavyweight Champion.
This is the aggression that you want out of a Shinsuke Nakamura. You don't want everybody to be friends. Seth Rollins won that championship, and he said, I'm going to defend it against everybody. What good does it do to be his best buddy? Shinsuke Nakamura is reminding everybody it's not fun to have him around. He's the king of strong style, and he's very, very dangerous.
All right, well, Sam, we appreciate your insight. Sometimes you think that Matt and I are disrespectful, I think we're just being professional journalists, which you are not.
You're not a journalist.
I called you a journalist once, and I was quickly corrected. He is a broadcaster.
At least he's honest. A lot of the people on sports entertainment media are not that way.
I'm not.
But Sam, we really do appreciate your insight and breaking down everything with us. That's going to do it for all of our time at the Bump. First hosting episode in the Bump.
Very well.
Matt, thank you.
Your parents are here. They got to watch you about that. They got to see Sam.
Yeah, they did.
That must have been a thrill.
A celebrity in this world.
It was today. Well, everybody, thank you so much for joining us on this very special edition of the Bump. We have a lot to look forward to in the WWE Universe. Obviously, Santos Escobar. He will challenge Austin Theory for the United States Championship. I will be on WWE Now every single Monday, every single Friday. I will be in the studio with Matt Camp every single Monday, every single Friday for SmackDown Lowdown and Raw Talk. And of course, we have a big SmackDown this week, so there's going to be a lot to unpack as it relates to that. But for now, for Matt Camp, for Ryan Popola, for Sam Roberts, I'm Megan Morant. Thank you all for watching The Bump, and we'll see you next time.
You hold the belt.
Oh, you're going to hold
that
up?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I'll do the ones.
Oh, yeah.